virtual home visit for a child with medical complexity, home accessibility and safety by Dr. Kathleen Huth and Dr. Laura Amar Dolan in the virtual home visit working group.
We designed Jack's area for him, with the wider doors, the hardwood floors, the tile in the bathroom, the wider bathroom door, the wide open shower stall with the wand, all of these things were kind of with Jack in mind. Well, actually weren't kind of, they were with Jack in mind, and everything is first floor living for Jack. So from the minute you walk in the front door, you go to the right and you go through to Jack's bedroom, and right adjacent to Jack's bedroom is the living room, and through over to the kitchen and around to the bathroom. There isn't a part of the downstairs where Jack can't be, so that Jack can always be with us as a family wherever we are. And that was key. You go out to the backyard and there's a ramp that goes up to the deck, and so we can get him in inside and out from front and back and all the way around the house. And so there isn't a part of the first floor living concept that doesn't have Jack in mind.
Consider all of the things that Jack's family has been able to do to optimize accessibility of the home environment. They have ramps in the main doorways. It is essential to ensure that a child who uses a wheelchair for mobility has a means of getting into and out of the house. They have been able to design their home with wider doorways, which can accommodate medical equipment, for example, a wheelchair or lift. For many families, this accommodation may not be possible depending on their living situation. Jack has an accessible shower area with a chair. His bedroom is on the main floor for easy access. There are electrical outlets with appropriate extension cords near the care area. There is also a landline telephone easily accessible at the bedside with important contact numbers. Jack has a lift by the bedside to assist with safe transfers. Many of these accessibility measures may not be available to some children with complex medical needs in the home. It is important to consider these accommodations when assessing the home environment, when addressing any challenges with activities of daily living, and when ordering new equipment. An interprofessional team, which may include case management support, can be a helpful resource.
We live in the suburbs, and in our first house, we lived on the side of town where the power outages, when they came, would be for days. So the longest one we had was, I think, 4 or 5 days. Irene and Jack and Nick had to leave, actually, and go down and stay with her sister because they had power down there. But I stayed at the house, make sure that, the plumbing didn't freeze and whatnot. But in our area, if you lose power, it can be for, an hour, it can be for days. And we had to be prepared. That was our wake-up call to needing to have a generator. The thought of losing power for days, I grew up in Maine, and it's not uncommon to be without power, but there are things that you can do and you're prepared for. And we purchased a generator just to make sure that we were never without lights, we were never without power, we were never without a way to charge our phone and have communication. We were never without a way to wash and keep things clean for dosages, for the syringes, for all of the other things that you need to do to make sure that you don't have an unclean environment where Jack can't thrive. So that was important. Jack has a lot of equipment that requires power. Some have battery backup, some don't. The suction machine, the nebulizer, the BiPAP machine, the pulse ox machine, the enteral feeder, he has an oxygen machine. All of these things, not to mention the chest PT vest and the cough assist machine, all of these things require power.
Jack depends on medical technology for his everyday care at home. When thinking about safety in the home and emergency planning for a child with medical complexity, consider, what medical technology does the child use? Can the child go without their technology support, and for what length of time? Some children depend on their medical technology 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Knowing this information can help you to provide guidance on emergency planning. For example, in the case of an equipment issue, medical or weather emergency. ask the family if necessary medical equipment is readily available in case of an emergency. Ensure there is a charged backup battery for any technology that the child cannot do without. Some families may be able to have a generator in case of a power outage, though many families will not have access to this in their homes. Telephone and utility companies and local emergency medical services should be aware of the child's medical needs so they can prioritize the home in the case of power outages or emergencies. There must be a means for the child to get into and out of the house, and there should be road accessibility to the house for emergency responders. A safe home environment also means ensuring that families can pack a go bag with essential equipment to be kept with the child in case of emergency. This may include bag, valve, mask, or suctioning as needed for the child. Contact numbers and essential medical information should be posted near the care area as well as the home address with directions. A landline is recommended over a cell phone, as a landline will automatically reach a local dispatch with 911 calls and link to the home address. There must be appropriate power supply and grounding with three-pronged plugs, which is essential with appropriate extension cords in use. Consider fire safety measures, particularly if oxygen tanks are in the home. Tanks must be stored in stands and away from a heat source, flames, or outlets. Fire alarms and carbon monoxide alarms must be functional, and the family should have appropriate fire extinguishers and a fire escape plan.
The BiPAP has a backup battery. The enteral feeder has a backup battery. The suction machine has a backup battery. The nebulizer doesn't. The oxygen machine doesn't. So these are all things that, even with a backup battery, they're great, but they're only good for so long without a recharge. So even if you had a power outage for a day, that might be okay. But in a situation of a 3 or 4 day blackout, you're in trouble. So with the oxygen, we were kind of required to have oxygen tanks as a backup for, I believe it was up to 3 days. But with the other items, again, if you don't have an opportunity to recharge them, they become unusable. And there isn't a piece of equipment that we have for Jack that isn't necessary. He can't function without the nebulizers. He can't function without the suction machine. The enteral feeder, we could work through that with bolus feeds. The PT, chest PT, we can do it as a manual, but it's nowhere near as efficient as the PT vest and the cough assist. So there's some things you can work around, some things that really you can't. And without the ability to have that power available, it really puts Jack at risk.